This project started in 2011 when our chief investigator Freya did a project on Sierra Sisters Cafe in Port Adelaide, and it was a case study on one restaurateur, Stuart Gifford, who is on the panel here, and it was turned out to be a very interesting study. He engages in sustainable practices, and he's interested in encouraging public, civic participation. This made us think, are there other restaurateurs who are doing this, and what sort of practices are involved? So we applied for this grant, and we undertook research in the Australian component of the study of 20 restaurateurs and chefs who are pioneers in this area. We had three locations, Adelaide and Goulba in South Australia, and Melbourne in Victoria. Just very briefly why we chose these locations. Goulba is one of the first Australian cities to be accredited under the Slow Food Movement, which is also known as Cittaslow. Cittaslow in Italian means slow cities, where slow food is promoted as an alternative to fast food. It promotes involvement with local producers and the communities. The South Adelaide was chosen. The South Australian Tourism Commission promotes the city of Adelaide as an innovative, vibrant food scene. And of course, we are one of the, I think here in Australia, we have more restaurants per capita. So again, that was an incentive for us. Melbourne is the food capital of Australia, and it's full of bustling little laneways which contain so many different restaurants. So these were the reasons. I'm going really fast because we are running out of time, and I want to leave enough time for the panel discussion. So just a few of the names. We had 6 restaurants in Melbourne. They are Lentil as Anything, Charcoal Lane, Street Cafe Melbourne, Brothel by Juiced, Mesa Verde, and The Grain Store. And in Goulba, we had 4 restaurants. That's the Australian Circa 1858, Mother Duck Restaurant, Bombora at Goulba Beach, and Rankinus at the Whistle Stop. In Adelaide, we had a total of 10. Sierra Sisters Sustainable Cafe, the Organic Market Cafe, Organic Market and Cafe in Stirling, Etica, Ethical Pizzeria and Mozzarella Bar, Red Lion Shack, Cafe Tropo, Good Life Modern Organic Pizza, Locavo, The Corp Coffee Shop, No One Lose, and Experiential Cafe. If you haven't dined in this restaurant, I highly recommend. They're very innovative in their practices. And a key theme that emerged from our interviews was the restaurant as a model of sustainable practice with the view to influencing others. So we compiled an industry report, which we are launching today. And we had quite a few practices coming up, but given the time limit, I'm just going to go through it very quickly. Things such as fostering learning, engagement, and change among their stakeholders, providing healthy food nutrition insights to customers, educating about environmental impacts to stakeholders, introducing zero waste practices that spark similar ventures, developing social enterprises, addressing food equity, fair trade, fostering social connections. There's quite a few. I'm not going to go through the list because we're running out of time. So basically, I'm here to excite you about our report, and our industry panelists who have come here will be able to share this passion, hopefully, with you. Thank you.
Thanks, Jay. Thank you very much for that. Okay, everyone, we do have this lovely panel to bring out some ideas about what restaurants and cafes can do towards sustainability. One of the most thorny questions we got in the research as we went to interview people is, what exactly is a sustainable cafe? Just to outline that for you, we're using the triple bottom line approach, but when most people think about sustainable cafes, it almost becomes a shorthand around the environmental side of things. But with the interviews that we did under these 20 restaurants and cafes, we found that there are quite exciting social initiatives happening. And of course, the economic side of things are a focus. You know, no enterprise isn't focused on the economic viability of it. So we were using basically the Sustainable Restaurants Association's parameters for that in the thinking about it. So now what I'd like to do is to tap the knowledge, the collective knowledge we've got of the panel. So if I can, what I'll do is briefly introduce them to you. And then I've got a few questions that I want to ask them that would bring their experiences to you and also perhaps raise what the future looks like in this area. So not in any particular order, but maybe the one that's traveled the furthest, I'll start with Cassie. Cassie Duncan was a supporter for this project, and she's a co-founder of Sustainable Table in Victoria, operating in Victoria and New South Wales in particular, but all around the country. And I'm really hoping her time here today makes South Australia stronger in the work that they're doing with her colleague, Hayley Morris. And Cassie's had a long experience of commitment to work through the nonprofit sector. She's got a degree in, and I wrote this down, arts and business marketing. I like that combination for our work today from Monash University. She's said that one of the highlights of her work is the creation of this publication, Sustainable Table, which is a really lovely publication. I think it's still available. It's done a second edition. It's had quite a big impact, and it's generated over $200,000 for Sustainable Table, and it's won Best Sustainable Food Book in Australia in 2012. So there's some interesting work there. And then Sustainable Table works on promoting sustainability in the food sector, not just restaurants. It's wider than just the restaurant and cafe sector. And it's getting people to think about what they eat, the ethics of what they eat, and the sustainability of that. So we're quite lucky to have Cassie here. So if you would, I'll get you to clap for Cassie and welcome her. And thank you. And then going by distance travel, maybe Graham is my second distance person. Graham is well known in the community in the Adelaide region. Having come here from somewhere on those eastern states, I've forgotten where you've come from, but we'll ignore that because it doesn't matter. He came in the 1980s attracted by our state theater company, but he saw the organic market in Stirling and was inspired by that. And he and his partner soon bought that up and created a Whole Food Cafe in 1992, which has been leading the way to some degree in Adelaide. But interestingly as well is the store with it, and then he's got export into Asia of organic foods and promoting organics. And then the new venture is the online shop, which is getting these products easily available. His business philosophy is about embedding sustainability in the business, thinking about the purchasing of goods, the packaging, the waste disposal, growers. He's got one of Adelaide's first electric car charging stations, I think. And then thinking about staffing and customer service as part of the sustainability of the business. In assessing his work, he aims for 100%, but he judges that he's at 80% now, which I think is pretty good. And the other thing about this sector is they're always critical and demanding more of themselves, which is a lovely thing to see. So if you would please welcome Graham Murray. Thank you. And then last but not least, the person that caused all this trouble and has ended my sustainability in life is Stuart Gifford, who I have known for a while, but it was in 2011 that we were talking about what his Sarah Sisters Sustainable Cafe in Semaphore does that inspired the 2011 pilot project leading on to this big project about sustainable cafes. And Stuart is the designer and the co-founder of that cafe in Semaphore. He also has experience in urban design, I think that's the right word for it, and is a design leader and serves on design panels and thinking about design in cities. He's been pioneering in the work of local healthy and ethical food concepts for more than 35 years, having iterations of Sarah Sisters from Hutt Street migrating through the Adelaide region over the years. And he has a restaurant that is very interesting in ethical and vegetarian cuisine, but also working on a plat du jour sort of concept. And he is pioneering work with community, building community through the cafe and the restaurant. The newest thing he's doing is working with local schools, getting schools, gardens to engage with providing food for the restaurant and building networks of community through these gardens, working with the restaurant and wider than that. And he's going from generations at the top to the bottom. He's working with older people as well. He's got projects working on the Exchange ACH group, Good Lives for Older People. So you can see that he's got a concern with community building. Would you please welcome Stuart Gifford? So now I've got these lovely panelists. The trick for me is to bring the best out of them in the time that we have, realizing that we are between you and good food and wine. So we've got that on the mind. We've been talking about food. We'll get there very shortly. My first question for each panelist, if you don't mind, is just to tell us a little bit about yourselves and your vision of your work, if I haven't already taken your thunder.
Okay, I'll start. I started Sustainable Table back in 2009, and I guess it really came from a consumer point of view. I found the whole ethical food space extremely confusing, and I wanted to find a way to make ethical eating easy. There was also a little bit of a light bulb moment when I was running some education sessions with friends and family, and I was trying to get everyone engaged in climate change and the environment, and I was sort of, this dull look was reflected back at me. And then one night we hosted a session on food and the mood in the room changed, and I felt like we'd found that one thing that we all have to do and engage with, and it doesn't discriminate. You don't have to identify as an activist or an environmentalist. We all must eat, and what we do eat has the power to change the world. And that was where the seed was really planted, and that's where it's gone from 2009.
Thank you, Cassie. Graham.
As you mentioned, I came to Adelaide and another job, and then I became a groupie at the Organic Market, which was actually established in 1982, I bought it in 88, so I've been there for 26, 27 years now. Very much right from the outset, being organic, obviously, in those early days before certification and everything came in, we actually endeavoured to try and get an integrity within what we were selling to make sure it was organic as possible in those days before certification. Then when certification came in, we were able to really streamline our fruit and veg section particularly, and we only sell certified organic fruit and vegetables. So that for us was very much the start of the sustainability side of it. We also became very aware of environmental factors as far as packaging and other goods that we were handling within the business itself. And I guess that really is not our main focus, but we've actually really honed in on packaging, the way we handle all our waste products. For instance, we actually, the back of our shop is just five different bins. There's food waste, which goes to one of our growers, who then brings back vegetables, having composted it all. We actually have cardboard bins, we have plastic bins, we have styrene bins, and we have compostable bins, and then we also have general waste. And that's flowed through into our everyday handling of product, using biodegradable and compostable products throughout the business. And I guess that's where we're at the moment. Yeah.
Thank you, Dan. And Stuart?
I was very lucky in the 70s to be exposed to all sorts of visionary ideas. When we were talking about the different ways of studying, at that stage I studied architecture at the Institute of Technology, and there wasn't a single topic nor a subject talking about sustainability or sustainable design. However, we had a self-help institution just down the road called the Third World Bookshop, which is a very alternative bookshop, which amongst other things happened to open till midnight. It was also a very welcoming one where you could go in there and take a coffee in and sit down and read any of their books. and that was my early education system. And that was obviously very alternative. That's the way Adelaide was in the 70s with Don Dunstan. I also had the absolute privilege of working for the Monarto Development Commission designing a brand new city. It would have been the most sustainable city in the world and the leading city because of the Dunstan era and the information and expertise which was mounted in Adelaide. And so I've been in a situation of seeing what visions could have been used. And that, of course, came to a sticky end. When it did, they found jobs for us elsewhere in the public service, which were well-paying but not necessarily meaningful. At the same time, I was just finishing at art school, and I talked to a lecturer, or he talked to me, and I was fairly good at the subject, very good at design, and he said, "Now look, you're awfully good at design, but don't go out into the world and try earning money by doing it, because you'll compromise every day, every week. Go and do something you want." So the thing which I wanted to do was open a vegetarian restaurant. And when we talked before about profits in hotels and cafes, those figures were about right. So you don't do it for the money, but you do it for the thing you'd like to do. And that's the thing which drives a lot of people in sustainable cafes and elsewhere. And it means that you do it right. You have to do it right to survive. And that's what we did. But it was a natural thing we did. We opened with the mantra, and this is 1978, of saying fresh, local, seasonal. And of course, that's the only thing you read about in the paper these days. So we've had to have gone all that time to get back to the same point where it is now the right thing to do as a marketing ploy. But as Freya said, our most exciting thing now is to be working with schools. And effectively, we're squeezing sustainability and other things into the education system almost by stealth. And that's very exciting. We can actually see those processes in schools where the kids are actually, well, certainly the teachers and the principals are the one driving this, and the kids are actually getting the kids to do the very same thing which we've talked about before, of them sorting out their own ways of doing studying. So that's the most exciting thing.
Thank you, Stuart. Now, Stuart, I'm going to stick with you because the next question asks about the effectiveness of cafes as tools for promoting sustainability. In this research project, we were looking at cafes and restaurants that use the cafes as tools to engage stakeholders and teach stakeholders about sustainability. So can I ask you, when you made that change and you chose to open your vegetarian restaurant in 1978, I think you said, what is it about the cafe that works as a tool to engage people in sustainability? What makes it effective? Could you tell me your views on that?
Back in 1978, it was the culture of Adelaide, so it was the right time, the right place. We opened our doors and people poured in. That's changed very drastically until now, and it's very opposite. So we now have to work an awful lot harder, but we still use sustainability as our main marketing tool. We read about these odd diets, and often they've got no evidence to base them, and that's very frustrating at the moment because I think they're dangerous. Things like paleo, things like the Wellbeing Diet book, some of these things are terrifying because they're not based on evidence, and here we are talking about evidence. So the evidence for us now comes in the way of people voting with their feet, and we've had a bit of a tough battle, but we got really good staff, so it's a very easy process. But all of a sudden we're now getting the recognition, and it's only because we're using sustainability as marketing. It's our only point of difference between us and 46 other cafes in Semaphore. We're now rated by TripAdvisor as number one. And TripAdvisor is a hospitality and tourism site. So they're the ones that the people go to and tell the story. The old media are not interested in us whatsoever. They still rattle on about celebrity chefs and all those things, which is fine where they play their role. But the only difference, as I say, which we use for marketing is point of sustainability, and it works.
Thank you for that. And Graham, I noticed that you've got a major market associated with your business for organics, which is really good. But can you explain to me how the cafe serves your purpose of engaging in sustainability issues with the public?
Well, I think we've never really Well, I suppose we have pushed sustainability. I haven't overtly been out there saying we're a sustainable cafe, blah, blah, blah. I haven't actually done that, but I think we've done it by example within the running of the business. You know, like all our coffee cups are PLA lined, they're cardboard PLA lined, which is a grain base liner with the lids as well. All our packaging, other packaging is recycled cardboard. We try and set the example if we can. You know, the public can actually see the bins out the back of the bench where all the girls are. They're all there's plastics, there's paper, there's cardboard, etc., food waste, etc. So again, we're just trying to do it by example, and rather than actually lay it out there openly.
And that example serves for your clients of your business, your customers, but also for other restaurants and cafes and other businesses in the Stirling area.
Well, it does. You see, the whole thing about separation out of goods, we used to, our general waste bin, we used to empty twice a week. They'd come in and tip it up and empty it twice a week. Once we started separating stuff out, we're actually down to one bin empty every 10 days. So we've actually saved money. We've actually saved about $150 a week just on that. Because what we're finding is that the refuse company will take separated compostable styrene plastic. The food waste is going to the grower. So that in itself, I think, is working for the cafes. We've actually put in rainwater tanks, so our toilets are actually flushed with rainwater rather than mains water. So we've actually we've done that. We've actually lowered the wattage on all our lights. We've gone down from LED 56 watts. We're down to 20 watts. We're slowly changing over to straight LED lights, which is cut further. So I think cafes, they can do it. They can do it slowly. They don't have to go in overnight, but they can do it. And the other thing that happens too, which I've found, is that the staff themselves, it's an educational thing for the staff. They've actually become aware. You know, so therefore, hopefully when they go home, they actually are starting their own recycling, et cetera, et cetera.
Thank you for that. So it's showing multiple levels of change. Now, Cassie, I note that Sustainable Table doesn't focus only on restaurants and cafes, but you've got that exciting program called Give a Fork and some other things that Sustainable Table's involved in. So would you mind speaking a little bit about that work?
Yeah, so Give a Fork is our annual campaign to raise awareness around food system issues. And we see cafes and restaurants as an incredible vehicle to start the conversation. And as has been reflected, it's not necessarily about preaching to your customers, it's about practicing what you preach and sharing that knowledge. Something that strikes me is that unfortunately the vast majority of people still do the majority of their shopping at supermarkets, which means we've lost the opportunity to have a conversation with the people who are artisans of their craft, so the butcher, the baker, the fishmonger. So the real opportunity to have a conversation about produce and to have a conversation about knowledge, it occurs at cafes and restaurants now, and I think that's a really exciting opportunity. And I think too, I always think about chefs now, and many of them are treated as celebrities, where once upon a time that was a profession you went into if you didn't really identify as being particularly academic. And so restaurants and food businesses are trendsetters. We've seen that people will fly internationally to visit food destinations. So based on that, surely cafes and restaurants can lead the trend towards sustainability, and I guess that's what really excites me.
Thank you for that. My last question is, because the three of you have been leaders in this area and at the cutting edge, just your views about what the future in this space might be. So if I could ask each of you to just give us some ideas of what you think future trends will be or should be, that would be really helpful. So Graham, could I start with you this time?
Future trends. As Stuart mentioned earlier, it's it seems to be a bit of a revolving cycle, the way things have, the way we're going back, you know. In fact, I was just chatting to Bronwyn, my partner, yesterday about, we're talking about coffee, single origin coffee, and how I remember when I first arrived in the 80s in Adelaide, that fantastic coffee, I don't even know if it's still there, in Central Market, that used to have all these single origin coffees, Kilimanjaro coffee and all that, and we were buying all that. And now it's actually become really fashionable. You know, every cafe now wants to have their single origin coffee. I do actually, personally, I'm not a single origin coffee person, but I actually like a strong, robust coffee, so I actually like a good blend to actually to give me the hit. Where are we going? How do we do it? I think the public are actually going to push it. Like the people are demanding it, starting to demand it. You know, it's like GMOs in food. You know, that we're still way behind in getting all that labelling on our products, but it will happen. And I think you as the public need to actually demand or lay the seeds in cafes and restaurants to actually get them to change their practices. Is that feasible, Stuart?
Stuart.
I think so. I think it's do things by example. That's why, for us, it becomes worthwhile for everything we do. It's because we've got a model which everybody can learn from. And a lot of that we do via Facebook, and we push Facebook very, very hard. When we were talking about it before, in effect, it's an educational tool. We are in a position where we can say what we want, so in contrast to a whole lot of big businesses, we're absolutely independent of anyone at all, so we can say very strong things, and we do that on Facebook. The other thing I keep on hearing about and reading about the education system, a lot of the information coming from the United States, is that our education system is so far behind where it should be in terms of educating the public. Or educating anyone at all, we're saying just consider what we're doing now, and it's just no relation to what the environment's going to look like in 10 years' time. We're going to have to change all of that. We're going to have to get that into the system to change the whole thing. So we're introducing these concepts into everyday living, everyday thinking. So it is, again, it's being driven very strongly from the bottom up, but the ones who are at the bottom, like Graham, like ourselves, is that we have to be right in what we do. We have to be so accurate in what we do. We can't just say anything we want. We've got to have a reasonable amount of fact. The other one, we've got to sell the sizzle, and this is what Graham does. As he said, he doesn't have to get there and preach, but what you do if you go up to Stirling, because you've heard of the reputation, you drive up to this lovely place in the hills, you drive up this lovely shady street, if you're lucky you can get a park, you park under a shady tree, you're walking through a shady courtyard full of bustling people, kids, families, dogs. It's buzzing like crazy. And then you go past an electric car charging station. Then you walk into a cafe that is absolutely full of people and buzzing. And you know you have to wait on a queue on a busy day because that's how much demand is. And that's why it's worth going there. You've driven past all these other cafes, which are in effect empty. So that's going to be the difference. You make that choice on the fact that that's what it's like.
Thank you, Stuart. And Cassie, do you have any visions for the future?
I guess mine is all grounded in transparency and honesty. I think there's a real trend for people to say that everything is local and seasonal where possible, but what does that really mean? And there's been so many instances where, you know, I'll ask if something's free range and they just say, yeah, yeah. But if you ask, okay, what farm, they don't have an answer. So for me, it's about, I would love to see a future where restaurants can really be honest about where and why they're sourcing things, and maybe take people on that journey of it's not an overnight solution. There might be extra costs. There might it might reduce their profit. The customer might be having to be willing to pay a little bit more. But provide that conversation and that transparency. And I think from a technology point of view, what would be really exciting is I've always dreamed of being able to, you know, scan my menu item and be able to see what the source of the produce is right back to the farm and have each item listed and understood. And I feel like we have the technology available and therefore restaurants wouldn't be able to hide anymore. And that, I think, would really encourage a shift in the way we operate.
That's a really lovely vision. I think that's very pioneering. So thank you for that. Well, that gives you a taste of some of the insights that we've had from the leaders that were kind enough to be interviewed by us. I have to say that what we found was it was the personality and the sheer commitment of individuals to lead this space. And there are good people with goodwill, lots of energy and lots of commitment trying to foster the changes that we need to be a more sustainable place. And it's nice that when you're enjoying something of the luxury of eating out and enjoying restaurants and cafes, that you can know that you're contributing to creating a better world. That's a nice situation to be in. I would like to thank you for your attention. The funding from the School of Management and Le Cordon Bleu was very much appreciated for this work. We didn't expect to do this report. It came out because our interviewees said that they'd like to know what the other restaurateurs were doing. So we decided that we'd do it. I don't think G and Emily and I, Emily Moskow was a co-researcher with us on this, that we realized how big it was going to be. There is a little sheet outside that if you want to access the report, there's an electronic version available and you've got a URL that you can go to there to get the electronic version. And we are going to be working on distributing it a bit more widely that way. So we invite your feedback, have a look at the report. We hope you enjoy it. We hope that it also excites you about some restaurants that you can choose from. So thank you very much for your attention and enjoy the rest of the afternoon.